Get your big, I'm searching for a thumbnail face. How you gonna move my hand out the way?
Cause I'm gonna touch you.
So, hey guys, I do wanna do the intro. You have to do it just like I would do it.
No.
Welcome back to my channel. If you're new, welcome to my channel. I'm Vicky.
This Cam.
Is Cam.
We're about to record a highly requested video. And we hope you guys like it.
This is our third installment of our yearly Q&A. What is it called? I don't know. Ask Vicky and Cam. We need like a name for our ask videos.
If you have any good names for this segment of videos,
because I plan on doing this more frequently on our vlog channel. So,
go subscribe.
Yes, go subscribe to our vlog channel. If you don't watch our vlogs, you should. It starts back February every Sunday from now on. Besides the point. Yeah, we're doing our Q&A because we are coming up on our 3-year anniversary. Which it feels like we've been married for a lot longer than 3 years. At least to me, it feels like we've been married for like 5 years. And we wanted to do another Q&A for you guys because you guys love our Q&As. We're not going to be answering the same questions that we always, that we've gotten before. Like if there are questions that you guys asked that we've already answered, we're not going to be answering those because we've already answered them. So you can go watch our previous videos. If you haven't seen them already, you can watch our previous Q&A videos to see answers to those questions. So like, how did I know he was the one, and the baby question.
And your favorite qualities.
And your favorite qualities and all that stuff. We answer those really frequently, so you guys should check out those videos. I'll link them in the description box, and they'll be on the side of the video too. So yeah, we're gonna go ahead and get started. What's the best advice you'd give a couple preparing for marriage?
I'd say if you're in a relationship, that you should probably read this book that my dad got me. It's called like The Difference Between Love and Infatuation, because sometimes folks think they're in love and really they're just infatuated with the thought of love or being in love or being in a serious relationship. If you're preparing for marriage, I'd say, you know, definitely read up on some books, the 5 love languages, to really understand how you love, how you receive love, and how you give love.
Get around people who are married. Not to model yourself after, but to like kind of get some like wisdom from them, to kind of like learn from them, because the way I feel like we were prepared for marriage is like we grew up in a home where marriage was really important, and both of our parents were married and stayed married the entire time that we were growing up. So we saw marriage all the time portrayed in a positive light. And I think because the society we live in nowadays is so negative towards marriage, some people don't grow up seeing that. So it would be good to get around people who have been married for a long time. A lot of people ask about premarital counseling in here. Do we think it's important? I would suggest doing premarital counseling if you're serious, like if you have a ring serious, or if you're planning on, you know.
I think you should, anybody that's about to be married should do premarital counseling.
But yeah, I definitely think you need to prepare yourself by just surrounding yourself with the knowledge of what you're doing. It's like, if you want to be a doctor, you go to school to be a doctor, right? So you learn about being a doctor. So you would want to learn as much as you can. Marriage is mostly experience, so you're going to learn a lot from experience, but you do want to be kind of mentally prepared as well. Also, get your finances right. Good segue to the next question. How were you guys able to start your finances together, building credit, starting a savings, paying off any debt, taking out loans, etc., etc., etc.? Cameron came into our marriage with credit, and he already had loans from school and stuff like that. I didn't have any debt, any loans, any credit, anything. I was basically a clean slate. I didn't exist. So what we did was, when we first got married, like the very first thing we did was go to a financial advisor, and we had him explain to us everything about like money and loans and investments and
IRAs
and
savings, CDs,
everything, life insurance, all of that. all of our goals, like our money goals, our financial goals, pretty much everything that has to do with money, we discussed it right up front. So I think that was like maybe like the third month of our marriage we went and did that.
Of course, we started a bank account together.
Yeah, we got a joint account and we just went from there and we went and talked to a financial advisor. I would suggest everybody go to a financial advisor or somebody who knows money, because you need to know how to make the most of your money. She asked two questions. Can Cameron give advice to men who are trying to save themselves from marriage that aren't male influences who really teach, really reach out to men on this subject?
Just don't put yourself in compromising positions. That's what I would say. We probably shouldn't kick it, you know, at this time. Oh.
In the dark.
Oh. Gigi, be quiet.
If you put yourself in a position to be...
Shh. Hey, stop.
If you put yourself in a position where you can slip up, then you will. You know what you like.
Like I said, don't be hanging in the dark, Netflix it, chilling, you know, making it harder on yourself. If you're getting hot, go home.
How do you deal with disagreements and compromise? I mean, we have disagreements, but it's not like...
What counts as a disagreement? Like, what is a disagreement? I need to understand what's being disagreed about, because I feel like people have disagreements and arguments about petty things. Pick and choose your battles, bruh. Like, don't waste your time arguing about who didn't take the trash out. Like, why? Why does that have to be an argument? Just be like, babe, you didn't take the trash out? Oh, no, I forgot. Okay. Like
no
why
need
does
to go
it
any
have
further.
To, why does it have to be a whole thing?
Yeah, it doesn't need
I
to
don't
be
understand.
Any extended discussion.
Yeah, and even like serious stuff. Like, why does it have to be an argument? Like, you can talk, you can discuss things without arguing.
Men, we don't do all that. See, you need to. No, we don't.
They don't want to do that.
You lost me already.
So doing it is pointless. It's a waste of your energy.
You lost me already.
Chill out. Like, go somewhere else and chill out for a second and then come back to it when you are not mad. Always being mad about stuff, that makes men not want to talk to you about stuff. That makes them not want to talk to you when something's wrong. So then you just walking around mad and upset and don't want to say nothing because he don't want to hear your nagging and you don't feel like going in. Like, it creates tension. There's unnecessary tension. You can have conversations about things without getting upset.
Facts. If you're in a relationship, if you're married, you have to compromise. Like,
and I feel like if you really love that person, you won't mind compromising on some things. Like, you, even if you are standing really strong on something, you're like, I really want Fruit Loops today, but he really wants Cinnamon Toast Crunch, so I'm gonna go ahead and get a Cinnamon Toast Crunch, even though I really want Fruit Loops. So me and Cam never agree on what to watch on TV. Like, I can't stand watching basketball. And I know he likes his time to watch basketball. I'm not gonna come downstairs and take the remote from him and change the channel and be like, no, I wanna watch this. And you know I don't like this, so why are you watching it anyway? Like, it doesn't have to be an argument. Like, I let him have his time, I compromise, I'll go upstairs and do something else. You know what I mean? Like, you kinda have to just, you learn to do those things because it keeps the peace. Because I used to be so bad when you would like be watching basketball all night, or you be at the gym all night, and I'm like, dang, you could be spending this time with me, but you decided to go to the gym and be there all night. Like, wow, really?
I don't go to the gym and be out there all night anymore, so. Sometimes they just want to spend time with you, so they just gonna say stuff that sounds sideways, but really they just love you, and they just want you to be around. Okay, this one says, do you plan on staying in Chicago, or do you think you'll move somewhere else one day? We're gonna be here as long as God has, you know, work for us to do here. I'm not one of the people that just get up and, you know, move just because I feel like moving, because a lot of times you feel like doing a lot of stuff, but that don't mean it's good for you.
Right.
And I mean it's right for you. Our season to be here is...
Right now.
It's right now. I would like to live somewhere else. Of course, I'd like to live somewhere warm year-round. But, you know, for now, we'll be
right here.
How hard was it transitioning to married life? What are some things you all learned about each other after getting married? It wasn't hard, but it's just, you have a man and a woman who has never lived together, who were in long distance relationships, or who was in a long distance relationship.
Right, which other ones were you in?
We were in a long distance relationship, we had never lived together. So then, you know, being in the same space, a guy and a girl living in the same space is just different regardless. It's your own house. It ain't nobody else's stuff.
Yeah, that's what's
it's
different.
It's yours. Like, okay, like, okay. Like now, like you use my brush and my comb and stuff. Like that ticks me off. And so I got her own brush that's just like the one that I use that she can use.
But it's not the same.
But she still uses my stuff. Like that kind of stuff. Like that's the kind of stuff that pisses me off and upsets me.
I'm so used to using everybody's stuff.
If I borrow something from somebody, like if I borrow somebody's clothes, I'm gonna give it back to you the same way you gave it to me. Other people, they don't have the same respect, and I judge people like that. How you gonna ask me if you could borrow something of mine? You give it back to me in a worse condition. That's just messed up. That's disrespectful. And Vicky, she does that.
Okay, so what I was gonna say is, before you went off on this long tangent about how I used your brush, oh my goodness. Or transitioning to married life wasn't hard in the fact that I was married. Because actually, being married to him is the easiest part of my life right now. Because it's effortless. Like, I don't have to try to be married to him because I'm married to him. And we don't have to try to get along and try to live together in the same space. Like, it comes pretty natural to me, I feel like. The only thing that's hard is adulting. I think adult life is hard for me. I feel like at any point, anybody, married or single, has to learn how to be an adult. Yeah, that's the hard part to me. It's not necessarily married life that's hard for me. It's the adult part, like paying bills and keeping up with the house and cooking and cleaning for myself and him. I mean, you know, it's a lot of work. But what are some things you all learned about each other after getting married?
You learn so many different things. I mean, you can't put like your finger on one. You learn stuff like, you know, oh, she's really, really like a touchy person. Like Sundays at 3:00, you know, it's nap time. You know, and if she don't get that nap, it's not gonna really be a pleasant day. Checking up and checking in, you know, if I haven't been at home for a while, like, because when I actually drive to work, so I have an hour drive to work, then I'm at work all day, then I have an hour drive home, so before I come home, I always, you know, call, check, do you need any things or anything you want. It's like, that stuff goes a long way, because it shows that you're not just thinking about yourself, you're thinking about the both of you, you think about what she needs.
But like when we got married is when I really started learning him for who he is. Like he's really friendly. He's like the pipe of the lardy. He's super, super, super social butterfly. Like loves to talk to everybody. And like, I mean, there's probably one person in the world who doesn't like Cameron, you know? And I didn't really know that until I moved here and saw him in his natural element around other people that he's known forever. There's a lot of things that I've learned.
It's the best way to communicate effectively when you guys are in a tense place.
Talk.
Using your words.
Without yelling or cussing.
We set boundaries when we first started like dating. You know, it's like, okay, you're not gonna call me out my name.
Don't say anything.
I'm not gonna call you out your name. I'm not gonna disrespect you. You know, I don't do arguing. I don't do that back and forth, bickering and fighting. I don't do that. You know, when you're in those tense situations, it's easier for you to practice what you've set in place because you've been doing it since you've been dating. So the tense moment doesn't just come out of the blue. You know, there's a build up there.
Mm-hmm.
And if in those small tense moments you're not exercising and resolving issues the way you should, when the big issue comes, it's gonna blow up because you haven't been, you know,
practicing,
following those ground rules that you set.
I would say, like, if it's tense and you know you gonna say something stupid when you're mad, like, go to the corner and look at the wall and punch it or do something. Calm down first and revisit the situation later when you're not so tense. Whatever helps you to not act a fool. You have to get to a place where you're comfortable talking about things without being shaky and mad and upset and don't know how to put your words together, you know. So that comes with practice, though, and it comes with practicing being respectful and how to act accordingly. Make sure you catch stuff early, like don't let stuff build up.
How do y'all maintain the fun in your relationship? Also, how do you all maintain friendships once being married? Date night is every Friday. So we believe in date night. We like going out on dates. And then we have other couples and friends that we like to hang out with. We're not in this boat alone. We try to be spontaneous when we travel. You know, we try to do different things and not do the same things all the time. Because that can become mundane and boring. It can become a routine. You're like, man, you know, for guys, it's like, man, we always do this. What's wrong with you know, doing right. that. And
women want adventure. Women want, you know, cute, fun stuff that they see in the movies and stuff like that. They like to be romanticized. And men don't think like that. So sometimes you have to be vocal about it and be like, hey, I want to do this. Let's go do this. And you have to keep saying it over and over again so they remember. That's nothing wrong with that. That's how guys think. They're different. They're different than us. You have to work with them. You don't even have to go out to have fun, whether you're watching TV or cooking dinner or folding socks. Have a competition who can fold the socks the fastest. I don't know. We play games on our phone together. Like, we send each other memes and... I mean, obviously you marry that person because you like to be around them. Yeah, I genuinely enjoy being around Cameron. Like, he's actually, like, really fun to be around. You know, it's not... It shouldn't be hard for you to have fun with your spouse. And like Taylor says, bring out the freak of the week.
Gotta do it.
Gotta do it.
Vicky, as a very independent young woman, I struggle with the idea of giving up independence in marriage. How do you balance that desire for independence with embracing a sense of selflessness in marriage? Before you start, okay, if you have a strong desire to be independent, you don't want to be married. Because there's no independence in marriage.
There isn't.
You make it sound like marriage is like slavery. Like,
it's definitely not. You can't go into a relationship with that kind of mindset. Unless you're willing to change. Unless you're willing to let go of that independence. But it's going to be uncomfortable for you. Being vulnerable and being transparent and being selfless and thinking about someone else. It's not always going to be a comfortable thing. And for somebody who's very independent and doesn't want to do any of those things, you're not going to like being married. You'll get upset and you'll want to leave. And then you'll go to the next person and get upset and want to leave that person too because of the same problem. And then you'll think it's everybody else when really it's you. Marriage is a two-way street. It's not one person depending on somebody else more than the other. Like, we both need each other. That's why you get into a marriage. That's why you marry somebody, because you need them. You don't marry somebody you don't need. Then what's the point of marrying them? You need that person in your life because they make you better. You know, so being married does require a lot of selflessness and a lot of dependence. Not just like financially or whatever, but like emotionally and mentally, you're gonna need that person to help back you up sometimes. You know what I'm saying? I mean, men say that they want an independent woman who has her own and she got her own money and she got her own. To me, that's a very, very negative way of thinking, because then they feel like they're not gonna be responsible for you.
Shallow.
If something goes down. Like, men have that natural instinct to want to leave. Obviously he's gonna want to be able to provide for you, and if you don't want him to, then you saying I don't need you. So then he's gonna be like, well, what's the point of me staying with you? I could go be with somebody else. You know what I mean? You gotta stroke men's ego. That's how they work. That's just how it is. Like, you can't change how men are. That's how they are. So if you don't want to cater to that, then don't get into a relationship.
Pregunta for Camarón. How did you make the transition from being a single male and not having as much responsibilities to preparing yourself for being the head of the household, both physically and spiritually? Well, first, you need to read the Word, the Bible. Second, I had people in my life who helped me understand the power and importance of marriage. Like my father, who's been married to my mom for 30 years. And, you know, we always had, you know, real talks and conversations about marriage and understanding women. You know, you have to learn how to manage what you're making on your own before you can manage a whole nother person, adding that person to what you're used to doing. And, you know, just understanding how to be selfless. Marriage is not two people trying to agree on, you know, different things. It's us as one,
right?
You know, making the commitment that, you know, we're in this. Like, I choose each day. Like, every day is a decision. You know, I'm looking for this, I'm looking for that, I'm looking for that. But it's like, dude, okay, once that, you know, it falls and once that drops, you know, are you still going to choose to love? You know, are you still going to choose to, you know, take care of your responsibilities in the house? Have you ever dealt with in-law drama? No, we have none of that. Both of our parents are friends. They hooked us up. There's no drama between nobody in our family.
So
if there was drama, we wouldn't be married. We wouldn't be together. Do y'all feel like the honeymoon phase is over? If so, has that brought y'all closer?
I feel like it's over.
Yeah, I feel like it was over. Like, last year was a very trying year for us, and that's when it really hit us, like, man.
We married, bro.
Like, life.
Life, though.
Life is real. Bills continue to come on top of your problems and your issues that you're trying to get through.
Right.
Huh. Folks still need their money. Huh?
Huh?
I can preach on that.
It's now, funny you know what's funny? I actually didn't like the honeymoon phase as much as I like the adult phase. Even though adulting is hard in itself, I like our marriage better. Like, I like you more now that things are harder, because now I actually see why I married you. Before, we was just cute and like, let's go on dates and ooh, let's match and ooh, we're married, ooh, like, you know, that kind of thing. But now it's like serious stuff, and now I actually am starting to see why I love him so much, because like he's really living up to the things that he said he was gonna do for me. So like, you know, being a man of his word and
Gigi, stop.
Just kind of like, can I say that our sex life is better? We've gotten to know each other better. We've become more open with each other, and you know, we've kind of learned each other and learned how to communicate better. All aspects of our marriage are better, okay? So, like, it just, things go so much smoother.
Y'all make being married look real easy. How hard is it to be married knowing that you're this young? What do you enjoy most about being married? We are married at 22, 23. That has nothing to do with the easeability
or the difficulty
of being married, right?
Yeah.
Marriage is a journey.
Whether you old
whether
or young.
Whether you get married at 18, 22, 35,
it's always
40,
gonna be a,
it's the challenge is yet the same.
Two different worlds, two different brains, two different lives coming together. No matter how old or young you are, that's always gonna be the case. What y'all see looks easy because that's what y'all see.
Even if you were to know somebody, like, you don't know every aspect of
and that's one thing
life.
I've learned being married is I didn't even know some of the stuff my parents went through because they never told us. So to me, marriage looked easy because they made it seem easy because they didn't show us when they were upset or, you know, struggling financially or whatever the case may be. They made marriage look fun and happy regardless of what was going on. And that's what I always wanted. So even now with us, when things aren't going right and when things suck, we still make marriage look fun and happy because that's how I know how to handle things. And never think that anything is easy for anybody, because you never know what people went through to have what they have and what's going on behind closed doors. You just never know.
What do you and Cam see as your next steps together? Like, what are your next big goals for the next year or two? Is Cam still thinking about becoming a pastor full time?
Where do we see our...
We definitely have some big goals. I don't necessarily want to talk about those big goals. We want to travel more. We want to meet more of you all.
Yes, definitely. We want to travel more.
We want to build and expand our brand, both together and our...
Separate.
You know, the Vicky Logan brand, the Cameron Logan brand. We want to build those and grow those and build those platforms, as well as the life of the Logans and what we do as a married couple. I'm a youth pastor now, and the goal is to become full-time in ministry. So, yes. Who are y'all's favorite YouTube couples and or celeb Christian couples that y'all like to watch or look up to?
We don't...
Like, YouTube couples? I mean, there's people that...
There's people we watch, but
yeah,
I don't have,
people
like...
Yeah, people
that
we think is dope, but, like, I don't look at their marriage and, like, I want to be like them. It's like, oh man, they make some dope videos. I mean, but
I don't look up to anybody.
I don't look up to them.
I don't really pay attention to other couples. We look up to like our parents. I feel like a lot of people today look up to celebrities and people on Instagram and people that they see in the media and stuff, but they don't even know what those people go through on a day-to-day basis, you know? So it's like, I would rather look up to people who I can actually talk to and ask questions and, you know, learn from, because then you're more likely to have a successful outlook on your marriage when you can actually, you know,
reach out and touch.
See. And even with like Christian celeb couples, I don't look up to anybody like that. Especially when I have good examples to look up to already.
Do you guys have any tips on how to build a better relationship with God or how to stay focused meaning focused spiritually. I started reading my Bible daily, but for some reason I let myself get distracted by either school or work. So, do you have any tips on how to build a better relationship with God? Prayer and fasting. The natural desires and the things that your flesh desires on a day-to-day basis, like food, when you deny yourself, things like that, and you decide to pray and fast at specific times throughout the day, and you say, you know what, God, I'm going to push back my plate, I'm going to deny myself, and I'm going to seek your face even more, then that's when, you know, you can begin to, you know, build a better relationship with God. He'll begin to speak to you more frequently and things of that sort. So if you get distracted by school or work while you're reading the Bible, you just got to kind of prioritize better, because you make time for the things that you want to make time for. So set aside time where you know there's limited space for you to be distracted.
Unplug, that's what I would say. Social media takes up more time than you think. You're scrolling for 10, 15 minutes a day. That time could be spent reading your Bible or whatever.
Cam, what's your favorite hair color / style of Vicky's? I don't really have like a favorite. Like for me, the whole thing is like, as long as your hair is done and it looks nice and pretty and presentable, I'm down, you know? That's really how I am. You know, whether it's short, long, blue, red. Now, if you have blue hair,
I was gonna do blue, but I feel like I would scare you again.
She has her moments where she comes home looking crazy, and you know.
But I work it out though.
I compromise. How was the home buying process?
We're gonna make a video about that.
Yeah, we're gonna make a video about that. But I will say it was great for us because church family, man. Listen,
church family.
If y'all don't get in a good church, man, you miss out.
When you get to know people and people begin to know you and love on you, then they'll bless you. And we were really blessed with a really good realtor who's known Cameron all his life. So he was very, very helpful in that aspect. But from a professional standpoint, he really helped us, walked us through the entire process, explained every single detail of what we were doing. It was super easy and it was super quick. That's why we were able to move so quickly. And people were like, wait, you moved? And I'm like, yeah, because it was so easy.
This is a question for the both of you. When you first entered your marriage, was it hard to allow yourself to be vulnerable? If so, please explain and share how you overcame the fear that comes with being vulnerable and open to your partner. I'm real, like, I'm a very lovey person. You know, she's touchy, I'm not. But, like, I'm very, like, I talk about my feelings. I express myself.
That was so weird to me.
You know,
I
tell you I love you every day. I show it in my actions. I don't always, you know, I'm not, like, all...
Oh, hey.
Like, that's not me unless we're in the bed.
I grew up in a home where we didn't show a lot of feeling. And so when things went wrong or when things... you know, we're kind of tense in the house, something like that, we kind of all shut down. So I grew up not knowing how to express my feelings openly and verbally. I was a writer, so I wrote stuff down. So when we were dating, texting was easy for me because I would just text him what I felt. Or even like making a video and he's not there. I mean, that's easy. I can talk to a camera. But when we got married, it was really hard for me to come out of my shell and let him get past those walls that I had built over time. Overcoming that, you just have to practice talking. Last year forced me to talk because there was a lot of things that I had been dealing with that I didn't want to talk about with anyone. And I started having to force myself to talk to people because I can't internalize my feelings anymore. That causes depression. It's really opened up a whole new world for me. I don't like being feelings oriented, but sometimes you have to be in tune with your feelings.
Do you believe a married couple should attend / belong to the same church?
Yes.
I do. Yeah. If y'all go,
that's division.
Y'all go to different churches, you know, the Bible says, how can one walk together except they be agreed? Not saying that's impossible, not saying that, you know, y'all living in sin or anything like that. You know, you guys are receiving differently as opposed to if you're under one house, you're under one roof. That's just like being married and, you know, y'all both
sleep in different beds. Since y'all celebrating 3 years of marriage, what is one thing you both have overcome for each year? I don't want to answer every year, but year three, I feel like we learn how to depend on each other more, not just, you know, to come home when you say you're gonna come home, but like actually like emotionally depend on him, because prior to that, I feel like I wasn't really letting him in. I think last year was like really like a wall breaker. Like, you really like scooped me. Like, when we first got married, I liked you, but like, I really like you now. Cause like, you like, I don't know, I got so close to, like last year, I feel like we were forced to be each other's best friend.
There was a lot of controversy too.
It was a lot of stuff going on in and outside of our personal lives. And so I feel like if you didn't have someone to lean on last year, you fell apart. And he was one of the only things holding me together, because I had reached a point personally, I just felt like I wasn't good enough, I guess. I don't know. I just felt like I couldn't do it. I could lean on him, and he was there to support me. So you ain't gotta worry about a thing. I don't know if that's a song, but I sang it.
You ain't got to worry about a thing.
You never know what people are going through.
You see me on the outside, but you don't know what's going on the inside. See, you think you know me, but you don't. Yeah, you did, yeah.
You did, yeah. But do you feel like that? Is that how you feel?
Yeah, I feel like this year, without saying too much, but I learned you really just don't know what people are going through. You know, and I'm talking about, you know, with her. Like, there are going to be situations and times where they present themselves where you really need to just be there and just really be a friend, a comforter, a lover, you know, everything that you know, God put you all together for.
Everything you vowed to be.
And for better or for worse, and those for worse times, you really need to, you know, step up and show, you know, why you're needed. Also, you know, there are other people that may be going through the same situation, but you just don't know until you get in that predicament, right. Like, man, and it kind of comforts you, because it's like, man, like, okay, we not in this alone.
And that's the beauty of being around people who are married, which is why I always stress that if you are married or you want to be married, get around married people who want marriage to work. I feel like it's so important to be around people who are going through the same things as you, because you need people to kind of like reinforce. Having married friends and having married, like, it's not just to be cute and say, oh, we have married friends, oh, we're married and we have friends who are married. Like, it's not, no, like, we need those people. Like, they're important parts of our lives. And so it's like helpful to have people you'd be like, dang, like, y'all going through that too, you know, and kind of like support each other in that way. That's gonna be it for our Q&A. So this is actually kind of like a intro, if you will, to a new series that we want to do on our Life with Logans channel. So if you're not subscribed to Life with Logans, you should be, because we're going to do more of these sit down videos where we talk, but we're going to like have topics or like a question that you want us to answer, talk about stuff. The first one, I know for sure that I want to talk about homeowning and purchasing large purchases. And I also want to do some like travel videos where we talk about, hey, we went here, this is what you should do, this is what you shouldn't do, this is how you, you know. Also, Cameron is going to be having his own channel, so you guys should definitely go subscribe to his channel, because he'll be having more, I don't know what.
Combos with Cam, where, you know, I address something that's been heavy on my heart.
I'm tired, so I'm going to take a nap. See you guys, we'll talk to you guys next time, okay? Peace out.